Hi everyone, thanks, welcome, thanks for coming along, all the rest. Matt's already stolen my opening gag, so, you know, let's just get stuck straight into it. Robert Briggs, sorry, I'm doing this in half lecture format, half reading paper format, and so at the moment I'm completely in lecture mode and I'm going to treat you all like students and introduce myself. I'm Robert Briggs. Today's lecture is on political animals, animals, action and attention in the online public sphere. Just to give you a bit of background where this comes from, it's based on the talk itself is based on chapter 4 of my forthcoming book, The Animal to Come, Zoopolitics in Deconstruction. Being published in the brand new Edinburgh University Press series Animalities, edited by soon-to-be professor, I'm sure, Matt Chalou, with a whole bunch of books coming out, hopefully at the end of the year, including this one, and ones to follow, including one half-authored by Matt himself. This book is an effort to think through what is often referred to as the critique of human exceptionalism or anthropocentrism that's kind of well underway now in humanities thinking. I don't think I really need to talk a lot about human exceptionalism and anthropocentrism, but basically the kind of presumption that really everything that's important in the world is centers around the human world, and humans somehow kind of separated from or transcend the natural world, and you know, to have some certain kind of exceptional attributes which distinguishes the humans from the rest of the world. And so, really, the human is the most important thing in the world. This has been critiqued. You know, got a long kind of history to this critique, but has really kind of started to get really underway over the last couple of decades, shall we say. Now, often this form of critique of anthropocentrism can take what I call a sort of moral critique, which is to wag fingers at bad humans and celebrate the goodness of the natural world. Notwithstanding the kind of terms that I just used to describe it, I don't have any in principle problems with that. But my interest is different. My interest in the critique of anthropocentrism is to look beyond that form of moral critique to interrogate fundamental concepts, the very idea of culture, the very idea of politics, once one starts to question the centrality of the human. Now, an idea of culture, for instance, seems utterly human, and certainly that the origin of the idea is tied to some sense of human activity. What happens to the idea of culture if we start to question the centrality of the human? In the course of doing so, in my book, one of the things I'm really interested in doing is attending to non-human conditions or agency, non-human forms of agency and their kind of implications and influence on human achievements and human history. So part of the critique of anthropocentrism and human exceptionalism is to think about non-human others as exerting force, having consequence in the world separately from whatever it is that we, you know, forms of consequence and agency we might attribute to humans. So the question for me is, what happens to ideas of politics, for instance? Once we kind of start to question the centrality of the human and the primary significance of the human. And a related kind of question is the extent to which our inherited ideas of politics, because, you know, we get our ideas of politics from the past, from a whole history of political philosophy, for instance, and, you know, establishment of various structures like democracy and so forth. To what extent can these inherited traditions of political thought accommodate the question of the animal? I put question kind of in italics to emphasize that we're not presupposing anything. We have certain understandings of what animals are, and we're going to suspend them in order to think through the possibilities of animals and animalities more generally. So to what extent can inherited traditions of political thought accommodate the question of the animal and contemporary animal politics? So that's the kind of background to the talk. Now, because LIHTC tell me that lectures aren't any good anymore, people zone off and go to sleep and everything like that, I've decided to throw in a few videos here to really kind of get everyone engaged. So first of all, hopefully the sound works. Okay, so just one other little kind of text to help contextualize the discussion to come. Hope you enjoyed those videos. This from a book called The Net Delusion, The Dark Side of Internet Freedom by Evgeny Morozov. You know how to pronounce that one? Have the Russian? No? Okay, all right. In a 2009 interview with the Globe and Mail, the East German dissident Rainer Müller noted how beneficial it was that the nation's attention was not dispersed in the late 1980s. You didn't have people looking at 200 different TV channels and 10,000 websites and emails from thousands of people. You could put something on a Western TV or radio station and you could be sure that half the country would know it. Few oppositional movements can boast such sizable audiences in the age of YouTube, especially when they are forced to compete with the much funnier videos of cats flushing the toilet. And indeed, we just saw one of those. Okay, so this is the background, the problematic for me. I think that quote's really useful for me to help kind of give a sense of the space of politics today, understandings of politics today, that kind of sense or structure of politics that the question of the animal might be asked in. Firstly, it speaks to a widely recognised and understood, in fact, almost intuitive and certainly commonsensical model of political action via participation in deliberative democracy. The way politics works and political action works is that you get an idea out there and we debate and discuss and informs people's choices and then we kind of act on the basis of that in order to institute certain legislation, for instance. But it also speaks to what is perceived to be a kind of key problem with the political space today and the prevalence of the media and the mediatization of politics, where as Morozov kind of notes, the kind of attention of a political public is fragmented and dispersed amongst all these competing forms of media. So there is the problem of political communication in the form of visibility and attention. In order to have your idea out there, your cause kind of promoted, you need to have people to see it, to attract that attention. You need to have some kind of visibility. And how do you do that in the context of decentralized communications when everyone in this room could all make use of different media and therefore have no kind of common focus? How do you get the populace's attention in order to get your idea or your interest or your cause the kind of deliberation that it is due. So this, for me, opens the question of how animals can appear, or how do they appear in the space of politics today? How do they appear, and how can they appear in the space of politics today? We can use, in the first instance, I think it's quite easy to understand that animals appear in the space of politics through what we might call recognition and representation, in the sense that, first of all, animal issues need to be, and animal subjects, if you like, need to be recognised. Their interests need to be recognised and then represented in this political space. Now, they're represented or not, as is often the case, in two particular ways, I think, that are relevant to this kind of structure of politics. In the first instance, animal interests are represented in the public sphere by animal activists and animal rights discourse. So we have things like Peter Singer's Animal Liberation as a book that was quite influential back in the 70s to help raise awareness of animal issues and the idea of like animal ethics, for instance. We have organisations like People for Ethical Treatment of Animals and the Animal Liberation Society, organisations that are out there trying to get animal issues into a kind of public consciousness. And we have films that was referred to in the news story that we saw, the Channel 7 news story, the vegan activism, Dominion, which is like a kind of documentary about industrial farming and the slaughter of animals and their treatment and so on. So all of these work together to help represent animal interests in the public discourse, in the sphere of discourse. But animal interests are also, I mean, it's not just simply to get those ideas out there, but the sense is that these are then meant to have some kind of consequence on the way in which governments manage, if you like, or govern processes that involve animals, or the kinds of rights and responsibilities towards animals, so that animal interests end up, or either being represented or not, in governmental processes and legislation by elected representatives. So we have things like the Animal Justice Party. We go to the election and we tip, you know, one for Animal Justice Party if we want to kind of represent, have animal interests represented in government legislation. We have the Animal Welfare Act as a form of legislation that sets constraints to what we can do in terms of our relationships with animals. And then we have forms of activism in the form of a protest, which is meant to, in a sense, in this model, be informed by that representation of animal interests in the discursive sphere, drive the action that puts the pressure on the governments to institute forms of legislation, such as the Animal Welfare Act, and that's politics. Nothing radical and new here. Hopefully you've just been going, yeah, sure, that's really obvious. Why did I bother wasting my time coming down this? Something that I know very well. We can kind of elaborate on this further to start to articulate some of the problems. So again, taking the vegan activism as the example from the news story, we can understand vegan activism as a new social movement for the recognition of animal interests, alongside a whole range of other forms of social movements that are there have been formed in order to represent marginalised interests. That's how this model of politics would kind of see it. And drawing back or referring back to the problem of visibility in political communication that Morozov referred to, we can understand that video where the activist dresses up as a cow, goes in the supermarket aisle and so on, is precisely designed in order to compete for attention, compete for the public's attention. It's there in order to then be put onto the news so that people see it. It's a performance, and so it's a particular strategy in the battle or struggle for visibility or attention in the public sphere. So my question is, to what extent to such understandings of animal activism, with that vegan activist one is one of the most kind of sophisticated forms, I think, insofar as it recognises that problem of visibility. To what extent do such understandings of animal activism challenge or diverge from the anthropocentrism of conventional politics? On the face of it, it seems to really diverge from the anthropocentrism of conventional politics, precisely because it's recognising animal interests and prioritising animal interests and saying, you know, humans shouldn't just be able to breed animals, kill them for you know, consumption. This is wrong. And so it's like challenging that centrality of the human in the world and that kind of sense of human sovereignty over the world. Nevertheless, the language of rights that often informs animal justice and animal liberation organisations is itself derived from an anthropocentric model of rights. The idea of human rights expanded to incorporate other animals, such that in order to be granted those rights, you need to, in a sense, measure up in some way to the human, so that we can go, okay, we're going to grant these rights to gorillas, or we might even go so far as cows, but you know, who cares about the cockroaches that are running around our house? That's not really what we're talking about. And so that language of rights really relies on this figure of the human for its very sense, and that becomes a kind of de facto measure for various forms of animal life. So in that sense, it remains anthropocentric. I'm particularly interested also in the way in which this representative framework where governments legislate on behalf of animal interests and, you know, put in forms of laws that prevent animal cruelty and try to ensure and improve animal welfare. This representative framework positions animals as the objects or targets of human activity in the form of legislation, such that, you know, it is still humans representing animal interests. And so it remains anthropocentric in that way. Now, the question is, how could it be otherwise? How could you have a form of politics, animal politics, that is somehow other than positioning animals as the objects and targets of political processes, as has them feature in such a way that it's not a case of humans representing their interests? So, for me, the way to answer that question, or to begin to see if there is an answer to that question, is to pursue other models of politics. And I'm, you know, looking back through a history of political philosophy to try to think through forms of politics that don't reproduce that governmental kind of structure. And an obvious way to do that is to go back to a time before there were governments, certainly the sort of governments that we understand today, state governments. And the German philosopher Hannah Arendt has done something pretty much like this. She, writing kind of in the around 1950, oh, there you go, 1958, that's when Human Condition was published, she wrote a book called The Human Condition, which is an attempt to recover, as it were, the original Greek understanding of politics. So the idea is that the very notion of politics can be traced back to the classical Greek city-state. And Arendt goes back through like kind of the sort of literature that comes out of that time and so on in order to kind of recover the sense of politics as it was understood by the Greeks. This is her understanding. I have real problems with this, but we won't kind of go there. But basically, it's a model of the city-state with the agora in the centre of the city. Again, most people will be quite familiar with this, but I'm in lecture mode, so where we have the agora at the centre of the city where people would literally, people, I say people, really men would leave their households and go to the agora in order to participate in politics, you know, give their grand orations, to discuss and debate, to propose that we do this or that, and so on. Arendt kind of looks back to this particular period to kind of get a sense of politics, which is obviously here, it's like it's a direct democracy. It's not mediated through forms of government and representatives, elected representatives, and so on. Now, Arendt characterizes this sense of politics as what she calls the sphere of action. Oh, that's my cue telling me I'm taking way too long. Okay, so action. Quick crash course in what Arendt understands as action. Political action is the performance of excellent deeds. It's not the work of crafting laws, legislating, protecting citizens. It's not voting. That's not what politics is, according to Arendt's account of how the Greeks understood politics. It is the performance of excellent deeds. So here, there are four kind of qualities of action that are worth highlighting at this point. For Arendt, action was understood to be a matter of taking initiative, what she calls natality. And I'm going to pull a few extracts out from The Human Condition. With word and deed, we insert ourselves into the human world, and this insertion is like a second birth in which we confirm and take upon ourselves the naked fact of our original physical appearance. This insertion is not forced upon us by necessity, so it's a question of freedom here, like labour, and is not prompted by utility like work. It may be stimulated by the presence of others whose company we may wish to join, but is never conditioned by them. Its impulse springs from the beginning which came into the world when we were born and to which we respond by beginning something new on our own initiative. So being born, because we were born, we want to be born again, as it were, to create things, to initiate things in the world, initiate processes in the world. To act in its most general sense means to take an initiative, to begin, to set something into motion. Because they are initium, newcomers and beginners by virtue of birth, men take initiative and are prompted into action. So it's this sense of natality of initiative as one key thing. Secondly, action for Arendt is essentially frail or futile. Futile doesn't mean pointless, why bother doing it, but in the sense of it can never last. It can't just last on its own, it will always come undone, if you like. It just disappears. So it's essentially frail, we'll skip that one. It's defined by its unexpectedness and unpredictability. She refers to it as being in the guise of a miracle. It is the nature of beginning that something new is started, which cannot be expected from whatever may have happened before. This character of startling unexpectedness is inherent in all beginnings and in all origins. The new always happens against the overwhelming odds of statistical laws and their probability. So again, it's something that's really unexpected. Which for all practical everyday purposes amounts to certainty. The new, therefore, always appears in the guise of a miracle. Just skip ahead. And fourthly, action is always a matter of appearing in public and acting in concert. One can act on one's own, but because of the frailty of action, it will just disappear in the moment that it happens, unless it is done in public and done with others to help continue the action. And this is, for Arendt, the reason why the city was, the city-state, the polis, came into existence. The original pre-philosophic Greek remedy for this frailty of action had been the foundation of the polis. The polis, as it grew out of and remained rooted in the Greek pre-polis experience, an estimate of what makes it worthwhile for men to live together, namely the sharing of words and deeds, had a twofold function. First, it intended to enable men to do permanently, albeit under certain restrictions, what otherwise had been possible only as an extraordinary and infrequent enterprise for which they had to leave their households. The polis was supposed to multiply the occasions to win immortal fame. That was the reason, it's to win immortal fame. That's why men acted. That is, to multiply the chances for everybody to distinguish himself, to show in deed and word who he was in his unique distinctness. The second function of the polis, again closely connected with the hazards of action as experienced before its coming into being, was to offer a remedy for the futility of action and speech, for the chances that a deed deserving fame would not be forgotten, that it would actually become immortal. So that was the point of the polis, to help create that remembrance and that ability for action to continue on, to be handed down. The polis, properly speaking, is not the city-state in its physical location. It is the organisation of the people as it arises out of acting and speaking together. And its true space lies not between, lies between people living together for this purpose, no matter where they happen to be. Wherever you go, you will be a polis. On this last line. It is the space of appearance in the widest sense of the word, namely the space where I appear to others and others appear to me. So the key thing here is like action as distinct from lawmaking, legislation and so forth. The unexpectedness and unpredictability of action. Even if one intends to do something, it's not that intention that defines it. Action is a process that is uncontrollable in that sense. And is this appearance before others, in the face of others. The space where I appear to others as others appear to me. And here's the rest of that sentence. Where man exists not merely like other living or inanimate things, but make their appearance explicitly. There's Arendt's humanism, anthropocentrism. It's like this action, politics is the space of the human, which again, until very recently, is what's always been thought. So now I'm moving to reading mode. So now's the time to fall asleep. Notwithstanding the overt anthropocentrism characterizing Arendt's overall argument, it is by virtue of its emphasis precisely on action and appearance that a phenomenological reconstruction of classical Greek thought may be said to enable an alternative approach to the animal to come as a political question. The animal to come is my kind of term that I use to think possibility, future possibilities. To the extent, for example, that such qualities as novelty, unexpectedness, and unpredictability appertain not to the initiators of action, but to acts or events of natality themselves, action as the performance of great deeds, as the beginning of something new, cannot be confined, strictly speaking, to what is otherwise thought to be the exclusively human sphere of politics. Indeed, the natality of action may be said to present itself wherever the spontaneity of action happens against the overwhelming odds of statistical laws and probability, which for all practical everyday purposes amounts to certainty. Arendt's words. Such natality may be found, that is, wherever action counters the various rules that, in Arendt's words, tend to normalize the members of a polity so as to make them behave, rules which would thereby serve to exclude spontaneous action or outstanding achievement. And so the effects of natality may be felt wherever action breaches, and again, Arendt's words, the conformism, behaviorism, and automatism that reduces distinctness and plurality to the level of a conditioned and behaving animal, which is to say, to the species character of animal life. So again, we kind of get that sort of anthropocentrism that sees animal life as automatic, conforming, unvariable, and it's human distinctness that elevates it out of that species character of animal life. It is in this sense, moreover, that the name action might be said to apply, contra Arendt, to remarkable deeds performed not only by human agents, but by non-human actors too. Thus, the efforts of clever Hans, the horse who could provide answers to arithmetic problems by tapping his foot, would appear to serve as an exemplary case of the startlingly unexpected happening, to use Arendt's terms, against the overwhelming odds of statistical laws and probabilities. Just clever Hans. Hans was a horse from like the start of the 20th century, where his owner, his name just suddenly escaped me, von Osten, would give him maths problems, and Hans would, with his hoof, tap the answer to the maths problem, give the number, and that's the answer to the maths problem. There was a whole bunch of other kinds of feats of intelligence that he did. Now, this was investigated, and ultimately, a guy, a psychologist, Oscar Funkst, worked out that what was happening is that Hans was reading cues on the part of his questioners, which effectively told him when to stop tapping his hoof. And so that's why, like, as in the anticipation, yes, this is the answer, and the horse would stop tapping just at that right moment. This is the origin to what's called the clever Hans effect in the behavioral sciences, and it's the basis for the development of protocols designed to eliminate experimenter expectancy. So the whole like kind of double blind in psychological and behavioral experiments and so forth. Clever Hans, I pick back up again. Certainly Hans's extraordinary performances, in which he would frequently give correct answers to multiplication and division problems, among other tests of intelligence, appear not only to have set him apart, to have marked his distinction from his conspecific contemporaries. As far as I know, no other horse could answer mass problems like this, but also to have won him a kind of immortal fame in behavioural sciences, at least, with a lasting remembrance of what is known as the clever Hans effect. Moreover, while his seemingly miraculous feats were attributed in the end to a capacity not for mathematical reasoning, but for reading involuntary cues, natural expressive movements on the part of his questioners, this fact does little to negate the startling novelty of his acts. Indeed, with a backward glance, we might justifiably claim that his was a performance which ultimately produced the occasion for others to act in concert in order to carry out a process thus set underway. These are all Arendt's kind of accounts, ideas of what politics is and what action is. For as Vincian de Prey tells it, Hans's actions not only prompted a series of innovations in the study of influence, but today remain significant for their potential to force radical changes to the theoretical and practical distribution of agency, authority, and interest in human-animal interactions. Central to de Prey's interpretation is not only the fact that in 1907, the German Board of Education established a panel of 13 gentlemen belonging to different spheres of social life in order to investigate the authenticity of the claims that Hans genuinely possessed such intellectual capacities. Nor is it simply that psychologist Oscar Funkst subsequently undertook extended experimental study, both of human subjects and of the horse's responses to questioning under different conditions, and was thereby able to conclude that Hans was reading cues that his questioners weren't aware they were making. In addition to these factors, which already speak to the beginning of something unexpected and a subsequent acting in concert, de Prey highlights within Hans's actions and the case more generally a degree of unpredictability which has continued to haunt his legacy today. For the story of Hans is routinely retold as the tale of the menace of experimental bias, whereby results from psychological and behavioural research are influenced by experimental expectancy. On this version of events, the actions of Hans and his human counterparts can be held up as directly responsible for the establishment and enduring authority of a cautionary research principle. But on de Prey's recounting of the story, this lasting remembrance has forgotten the most interesting and significant, the greatest, to use Arendt's Athenian schema, features of that horse's acts. While it has long been recognised, for example, that well-trained horses are excellent muscle readers, and this fact could thus be acknowledged in accounting for Hans's performance, Funk's report understates what perhaps set Hans apart even from these adroit conspecifics. Hans's reading of his interrogator's muscle movements, that is, was not kinesthetic in nature. As de Prey puts it, talented horses generally read the gestures and movements of their riders through their skin and muscles. Hans could read all these signs visually. Hans was truly talented. Further, the data acquired through Funk's own observations suggests that the communicative exchange, hence the flows of influence, between the horse and his interrogators was not all one way. As de Prey notes in a close reading of the psychologist's report, the form of the signals that indicate zero and no was taught to the humans by the horse without their realizing it. Depraved writes, when Funks asks his human subjects to think about the answer null or zero, he notes that the minimal gesture is not the same as when they are in the horse's presence. When they concentrate on the thought null or zero for Funks, the minimal gesture is a slight ellipse of the head. When they ask the horse, it is a shaking of the head that is observed, which is exactly the movement used by the horse to answer the question. How could it happen that humans replace their own spontaneous movements with that of the horse, unless we assume that Hans taught them the gestures he needed? Hans has made them move otherwise. He changed the habits of their bodies and made them talk another language. Where Hans's performances are largely remembered for having initiated the development of procedures geared towards eliminating influence, the clever Hans protocols, Depraved's reading of the case uncovers the more complicated relations of influence that the celebrated story has failed to account for. The result for Depraved is that Hans's testimony is always called upon to impoverish the range of explanations. And so we might say that this legacy of Hans is one which fails to remember precisely his outstanding achievement. For it is a story in which his distinctness is reduced to a conformism, behaviorism, and automatism that is taken to name, in Arendt's terms, the species character of animal life. Such is the unpredictability of action. The story begun by Hans' performances sets in motion a particular transformation to the practices of experimental research, practices that are in turn being transformed by another version of Hans' story. Now, the consequences of such animal action would understandably seem restricted, for the most part, to the space in which such action can appear, which means that we might expect its unpredictable effects to be identified in the first instance within the bounds of the science of ethology, perhaps psychology itself. In this regard, Depraved's rereading of the story of Clever Hans may well stand as exemplary, insofar as it recounts the establishment of an ongoing revision of a principle of influence that this talented horse helped to initiate. But the apparently specialist nature of this site of knowledge and authority begs the question of the extent to which the moments of such action may be called political with regard also to the criterion of being performed in public, which again was one of the features of action that Arendt highlighted. As distinguished as the clever Hans effect happens to be within the behavioural sciences, that is, can it be said that Hans's deeds are as well known outside those intellectual fields, even in other academic disciplines, let alone by a broader global public? Do these restricted intellectual spaces provide much scope for occasions of animal action to attain, in Arendt's terms, the reality that comes from being seen, being heard, and generally appearing before an audience? Perhaps pertinent in this regard is the fact that, having performed in numerous exhibitions of his talents across Germany, Clever Hans garnered considerable interest among the public at the time, with his feats being reported even as far abroad as New York. That's from a newspaper, 1904. It's a story reporting him in New York. Also significant here is the tendency for reports of great deeds on the part of various animals, animal heroics, as well as scientific discoveries of unexpected capabilities, to make their way into national and increasingly global news coverage. Thus, when honeybees are shown to be capable of counting or capable of being trained to count, and even of recognising a null set as less than one, it is not unusual to find such stories being reported in mainstream daily newspapers and broadcast media. Bees can count. That's literally the headline I saw. The border between a narrow space of appearance structured by specialist behavioural sciences and a broader public sphere appears itself, therefore, to be far from impermeable, such that the conditions of remembrance exceed those that define the action itself. And here, of course, the increased centrality of online media and communication to forms of appearance, communication and interaction, noted and discussed earlier, becomes directly relevant to the question of action. Moreover, it is here that the question of animal action becomes directly relevant to the problem of visibility and attention that Morozov characterises in terms of the net delusion. For her part, Depraved goes some way towards accounting for this new mediatic situation when she reflects on the increasing use of social media to publish and share videos featuring animals and human-animal interactions. Her primary interest in the phenomenon revolves around the extent to which it speaks to the site of a new ethological practice, understood etymologically, that is, as knowledge of shared manners, customs, and habits. Might it be the case, she asks, that the proliferation of these videos attests not only to new habits, but to the creation of a new interspecific ethos of new relational modalities that at the same time construct knowledge. Taking wildlife documentaries as a historical precursor and considering the role they've played in raising awareness for endangered animals, Dupre highlights the potential for the new ethological habits, what we might rename here new ethomedia practices, to transform the beings involved and the knowledge that unites them. Thus, wildlife documentaries helped introduce into scientific practices dominated by the logic of species and the study of populations, a concern with individual animals and personal histories, a shift in focus which proved effective in promoting the cause of animal protection. With the rise of social media sharing, with the slew of recordings showing animals, both domestic and wild, performing startlingly unexpected feats, cats opening fridges, octopuses escaping jars, dogs flying planes, monkeys stealing artifacts and holding their owners to ransom, elephants painting precise, if stylized, pictures of elephants, the customs may be said to have changed again. Dupre writes, other modes of knowledge are cultivated. Amateurs have taken over, and this time with unrivaled means of distribution. The animals are part of the cast, even more so than in the documentaries. They are talented beings, remarkable for their heroism, sociality, cognitive and relational intelligence, humour, unpredictability, and inventiveness. And they are now part of everyday life. Of course, these documents do not strictly speaking fall within the domain of evidence. Hardly anyone is fooled, as the comments beneath the publicly shared videos attest. Nothing is known about how these images were taken, and one can always suspect deception or the possibility that staging has occurred with or without the complicity of the animals involved. But nearly all of them speak to the evidence of the image. Someone saw it, and the images are proof. Central to these developments, then, is a transformation of the forms and possibilities of public appearance. Not only the emergence of new ways of making animals visible, as Dupre notes, but also a shift in the significance of such appearances. Where the aesthetic and scientific naturalism of earlier wildlife documentaries perhaps lent itself to a logic of protecting endangered animals through a focus on growing species populations and minimizing human interference, the new ethomedia space enables a different kind of response. For what characterizes many of these amateur videos is not their depiction of animals as victims, be it from a threat of extinction or in the performance of comic mishap, but rather their display of individual creatures doing surprising things that are not expected of them. This is what makes the clips interesting and arouses enthusiasm. Animals teach us about what they are capable of and what we have ignored. Dupre values these clips primarily for their potential to supplement and connect with scientific practice and to interest non-specialists in turn in the scientific adventure that mobilizes ethological research. In view of Arendt's reconstitution of the principle of action, though, it seems fair to say that this new ethological development is not without political significance too. If the beginnings enacted by these events of animal natality, which appear in today's ethomedia spaces, can be said to fall well short of the greatness that earned the Hellenic heroes their immortal fame, it is worth noting that when it comes to specifying examples of action, Arendt herself is circumspect, almost to the point of silence. And this is perhaps due to the fact that the only examples that could be cited are precisely those that have indeed earned their initiators immortal fame. But to take as the measure of action the great deeds recounted in the Homeric epics, for example, or in the historians' accounts of the French and American revolutions, is perhaps to cede to action such a rarity it could not rightly be counted among the fundamental human activities that Arendt collects under the name Vita Activa, the active life. To define action with reference only to those truly enduring tales, in other words, is perhaps to understate what is, for Arendt, one of its defining qualities, its frailty. Such frailty extends no doubt to these new ether media audiences before whom contemporary events of animal natality would appear, audiences whose constitution, as it were, is far from comprehensive and lasting. In the face of new media, we don't form a consistent, lasting audience. We are fragmented. For the fragmented, dispersed and volatile nature of the public space of appearance circumscribed by new and online media engenders in turn irregular, heterogeneous and transitory publics. But if such inconstancy appears to hinder the establishment of the permanence that on a rent's account is the meaning of politics, the distributive, sometimes virally so, and often emulative nature of social media production and dissemination is indicative of the reality of a commonly shared world nevertheless, replete with the simultaneous presence of innumerable perspectives that for Arendt gives expression to the condition of plurality, the human condition of plurality. I'm almost getting there, three more pages. Such mimeticism testifies, moreover, to the role that the new mediatic animal action plays in organising, even transforming, the society of men, understood in the sense of living and acting together. As Dupre suggests, because many of the experiences that are shared on the web are due to the common work between a human and an animal, from the mutual learning that has developed, from a productive complicity, from a game that has been patiently introduced, think back to that cat hide and seek kind of one there, we learn what we are capable of with them. Beyond instigating campaigns for animal protection, that is, the public appearances exemplified in the online videos that the prey discusses speak to other ways of relating to non-human animals, other forms of interaction, hence another kind of collective, even transformative action. They prepare for the invention of other modes or moments of living together, of acting together, and in this way inaugurate other spaces of politics, rival or competing spaces that thereby divide these spaces of politics itself. In this sense, the very volatility, agonism and heterogeneity that define today's ethomedia spaces might be understood less as undermining their political significance than as constituting their significance. Such public appearances may even be said, therefore, to contribute to the cultivation and constitution of the conditions for a new concept and practice of democracy, precisely as a thought and experience of living together that far exceeds the constitution or form of juridico-institutional government ordinarily designated by that name. Consequently, if the effectuality of this animal action would seem limited in terms of its scope to transform either the processes or rationales that define contemporary democratic governance, such acting in concert nevertheless speaks to the initiation and realization of something, as it were, new, a new place for animals and animality within the otherwise exclusively human sphere of politics. Indeed, the pertinence of the Arendtian recovery of the original meaning of politics, can be said to lie less in its reconstitution of a normative framework that would guide transformation of contemporary juridico-political structures than in its accentuation of the irreducibility of politics to the processes and institutions that define contemporary governance, democratic or otherwise. For politics, understood in the sense of the frailty of action, is precisely that form of activity which could not be submitted to a normative framework or some model of best practice. Since politics would be essentially a matter simply of what happens in the public realm of the so-called human affairs. In this regard, the new ethological practice identified by Dupre, the public appearance of animal action and initiative, the collective carrying out of that natality, points to the emergence of a form of political action or zoopolitical action beyond the spaces of representative government. Last paragraph. In arriving at this account of the space of politics, of the scope for animals to appear otherwise in such a space, we can begin to recognise then the extent to which the question of the animal can force an unexpected challenge to conventional accounts of the operations of politics. Beyond that is the extension of a sense of justice or obligation to animal beings. For the reading of online ethological activity initiated by Dupre presents a stark contrast to routine dismissals of popular new media use as failing to embrace the internet's potential to enable a truly deliberative democracy to emerge. where such a politics premised on a dialogical model of the public sphere as discussion and debate would perhaps despair at the widespread use of the internet for the frivolous purpose of circulating cat videos, for example, the question of the animal to come perhaps finds in such activity cause to rethink the fundamentally limited nature of that model of politics, predisposed as it is to privilege speech or action in the form of speech over other modes of political appearance and activity, and to identify governance as the very substance of politics. If the fact and the future of animals and animality is to be taken into account, in other words, political thought may have to give serious consideration to its tendency to reduce to mere everyday life all that activity which appears not to take the form of explicitly political judgment, action, and speech. Indeed, such thought may need to rethink the very form and potential of zoon politikon, that political animal whose actions and affairs the history of philosophy has taken as the source of political life as such. For what the interrogation of the public space of appearance underscores is the extent to which the phenomena of natality and action, but also for the same reasons of reproductive life and species behaviour, can appear as such only on the basis of their relation to specific technological conditions, formal institutions of government, technologies of communication, and so forth. From the perspective of the animal to come, therefore, zoon politikon names not the specific difference of the human animal, but rather a distributed differential space of appearance within which creatures of all kinds come to appear and to act in never entirely predictable fashions. Thank you. Thank you for your patience.